Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Sunday morning service. Those on our prayer list for Sunday, the 21st of June, are Marie, Christopher and Graham Williams, Michael and Margaret Brown, John Moore, Wendy Johnson, Lorraine Lavery. Also, please pray for Kathleen McBlain, Hannah Smith, Derek Boyce and Norman Wallace. No stories or things to say this week, but I do want to share with you a poem by Davy Catherwood. He wrote lots of poems, and they really do give me a lift when I'm down. And then there are others that really make me smile and giggle. This is one called "It Must Have Been Hard." It must have been hard to prepare to die. I'm sure that a teardrop filled his eye. Thinking of all that was coming to be, in order for him from sin to set us free. Of the disciples that would let him down, to the people that made the thorny crown. The mocking, the scoffing, and all the cheers. That yelling that did resound around his ears. Then to be nailed to that cross of shame, strangers mocking and shouting his name. The whipping that tore his flesh open wide, the spear that was plunged deep into his side. O Lord, we could never imagine your pain, but we know if needed, you'd do it again. When it was over, they took him away. There in an empty tomb his body did lay. Blocked and guarded by a giant stone, his body stripped there, lying there all alone. But we all know it wasn't the end. He rose and he lives and is my best friend. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, thank you for sending your Son to die for us on the cross, for giving his life and suffering as he did for us so that we can enjoy the life you wanted us to have, to be fulfilled and loving and of service and dedicated to you, to use our talents that you gave us to help spread your word and the news that your Son died for us. Thank you for all the blessings that you so freely bestow on us every day that we will all so often take for granted. Lord, help us to be more appreciative of what you have done for us and loving and serving to those around us. Help us to use the strength that you give us to spread your love and good news to all we see and to all we come in contact with. In Jesus' name, Amen.
The Lord is the light of my salvation, who shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life, and who shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is the enemy of my first foes who will stumble and fall. Though my army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though thou break out against me, even when I will be confident. One thing I ask for the Lord, is only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord, and to seek him in the temple. For in the day of the trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling.
Hello. Our family loves Donaghadee. And no trip to Donaghadee would be complete without a walk around the lighthouse. The lighthouse was built to guide the ships away from the danger of the rocks and safely into the harbour. Jesus is our lighthouse, our guiding light. In John chapter 8, verse 12, Jesus says, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Today, I thought we could make our own lighthouse to remind us of this verse. You will need a large cup or beaker. It can be plastic or paper, whatever you have. A smaller clear cup. electrical or decorative tape, some glue, scissors, black paper, and some tissue paper or foil. First of all, our lighthouse needs some stripes. I'm using the electrical tape, but you can use whatever you have at home. And if you're using a paper cup, you might even be able to draw on it with pens. Place your tape around your cup, and I'm using the ridges on this cup to guide my tape all the way around to where I started. And it's handy even, you can put your hand up inside your cup to hold it. When you get back to where you started, cut off your tape, and then we can do another stripe further up a wee bit, starting at the same place as we started before, and placing your tape round the top of your beaker. And making it back where you started. Now we can use the black paper to make a door and some windows. So simply cut a strip of your black paper. Cut off one door shape and then some smaller window shapes, however many you want. We can use our glue stick to stick these on our lighthouse. So there's the door. And some windows. There we go. Now for the light. If you want, you can use some yellow or white tape and put another wee stripe along the top of our clear plastic cup we're going to be using for the light. All the way around as before, and meeting at the back, and just cut it off. Now we can use our tissue paper or foil to make a light for our lighthouse. Simply take whatever you want to use and scrunch it up. Place it on the top of our lighthouse and then cover it with the clear plastic cup. And now your lighthouse is complete. Here are some I made with different types of lights inside. This one has tin foil, this one has coloured tissue, this is just another one with the white tissue. I hope you will enjoy making your own lighthouse, and as you do, remember that Jesus is our guiding light. And if we think of him every day, he can shine his light on us and let us know where we should go.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. Questions your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you. To show. tomorrow brings. With each morning I'll rise and sing. My God's love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are my light. My lighthouse, shining in the darkness. I will follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise. You will carry me safe to shore.
I've been walking down Donaghadee Pier to the lighthouse as long as I can remember. The familiar way many of us do, making our own rotation along the stepped limestone wall, then a long look out to the Copeland Islands beyond, before sweeping our gaze back to the colourful town and onward, probably back down the pier for an ice cream. I've done it in all weathers. I deliberately leave and enter Donaghadee in such a way that I know I will always get a look at it. I could show you hundreds of photos of that white tower, because every time I'm convinced it looks lovelier than it did the last time. I've been caught in its orbit ever since I was very small. In lockdown and being on furlough, I've sought these unchangeable things. One of the first things I painted during this time was the Copeland Islands Lighthouse. I wished we could all be there, away from the noise and fear of the uncertain world, and be as unbothered as the seals that stretch on the rocks beneath. I painted Donaghadee Lighthouse too. That steady rhythm it keeps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, flash. Again and again. So simple, predictable. The shape of lighthouses, I'm told, was designed to mimic the long-lived English oak tree that withstands storm after storm, enduring by being terrific at standing still against the odds. I think it's important to remember that as a Christian. You don't need to begin by whipping yourself into a flurry of activity in response to a current or indeed any crisis. I can tell you, as a creative, the pressure is strong to produce great, sustaining work during this unusual sabbatical. But anxiety has never been one of the muses. So I'm learning from the lighthouse to hold steady and breathe in sync with the light. In, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Out, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It may be helpful to know Yahweh, which is the Hebrew name for God, is written in aspirated consonants, simply meaning in their language that the vowel sounds are not spoken but breathed. That means that the name of the one who gave us breath is a sound of our own breathing. So I'd say simply to breathe deep is important. Start there. For centuries, mariners trusted these lighthouses that stood still and shone in deepest night. The engineering mastery was always in getting the light to be safe and dependable, because any fool can make a reckless fire. It takes character to have composure in the unknown. Jesus was a man of exceptional composure. We know he is our lighthouse and refuge, but since it is our destiny to embrace his character, may we also learn the stillness that comes from knowing our Father and his unchanging presence, whose comfort enables us to stand firm, who teaches us to live with a peace that doesn't quit, and blesses us with beautiful things in the unlikeliest of places. Know that you can place your feet on the rock or pier that weathers every storm. James 1 verse 17 puts it beautifully. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows.
Lord is my Prayer for others. Some words from the Book of Common Prayer, Gospel of St. John, verse 15-12. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. And from the Epistle, Isaiah 40, verse 1. Comfort ye my people, saith the Lord. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, at this time, we ask for your mercy and blessing. Blessings of healing upon those here named. Hannah, as you who recovers in hospital after the road traffic accident and losing her mom and sister. Pastor Norman Morrell, the Park Avenue Free Methodist Church, Derek Boyce, and Billy Holland. Also Tom and Beth McKnight as they battle their illnesses and cope with treatment. Also for Elizabeth McKnight and the family circle. We pray for those in the National Health Service, doctors, nurses, and allied health professionals. We pray for community care staff, bus drivers, and many who provide public services to meet our needs at this time. We pray for those who are unemployed because of the virus and the stresses and strains that they're experiencing. We pray for those known to each of us who are ill, coping with disability and long-term care issues. We pray for those in nursing homes, that they may be upheld in their work and that they will be strengthened. Heavenly Father, we ask for your mercy. We ask for your forgiveness. And we ask for your blessings, that we may, as Christians, live the lives that we should in your name. We pray in particular for our current pastor, the Rev. Curran, and for Elizabeth, his wife, who have served us faithfully in these past months and through this time of difficulty, and whose service is coming to a close this month. We thank God for them, for their worship, for their gospel preaching, and their pastoral care, not least myself and my family. Bless them in whatever they do in future, and may your Holy Spirit guide them in their work. Lastly, Lord, we pray for those who have lost loved ones, and we pray for those who mourn. We ask this in and through the name of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thanks be to God.
This morning's reading comes from Ephesians chapter 2, reading from verse 1. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do.
Good morning, everyone. My message today is the transforming grace of the Lord Jesus Christ in our lives. The passage is Ephesians 2, verses 1 to 10. In 1748, a wicked, immoral man called John Newton was heavily involved in one of the most despicable businesses the world has known, slave trading. By his own assessment, he was the worst of sinners, a cruel man who lived a life of debauchery and was greatly feared by the sailors under his command. One night during a fierce storm at sea, tied to the mast of his ship for fear of being swept overboard, his mother's teaching about the grace of God came flooding back into his mind. Fearing for his life, he called upon the Lord for mercy and for forgiveness. God in Christ transformed his life by his saving grace. Newton later became a preacher, pastor, and hymn writer, who wrote that well-loved hymn, "Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound, that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found, was blind, but now I see." It is Newton's own testimony and song that tells us of the marvellous story of the transformation from spiritual blindness to Christian vision by the grace of the Lord Jesus. Towards the end of his life, he wrote, "My memory is nearly gone, but I remember two things, that I am a great sinner and Christ is a great Saviour." When we consider the tragic, cruel death of George Floyd in Minneapolis and what others have experienced in similar circumstances, we need God's grace the world over to heal, transform, and restore lives. Our thoughts and prayers are with all who have suffered and are still suffering from the terrible sin of racism, injustice, and evil throughout the world. The Methodist Church in Ireland recently has said in a resolution on racism, "In the wake of the cruel and needless death of George Floyd, we call upon our Methodist people to stand up against the sin of racism. Methodists, informed by Scripture, have always believed in the dignity and value of every person created in the image of God. We look back to our roots and are challenged by the last letter John Wesley wrote a week before his death to William Wilberforce, who was campaigning against slavery in Westminster. He wrote, "O be not weary of well-doing, go on in the name of God and in the power of his might, till even American slavery, the vilest that ever saw the sun, shall vanish away." We call on all to engage prayerfully, peacefully, publicly and politically, to work together with others to eliminate racism in our world, our own communities and in our own hearts. Friends, that's the biblical message of the church. It is grace from start to finish. If ever there was a time when we needed to experience God's amazing grace, it is now. Only God's grace could change John Newton. Only God's grace can restore and change our world. Only God's grace can change us. And God is speaking loudly, if only people would stop and listen. He alone has the answers to our problems. God's way is the way of grace. We cannot solve the problems in our communities ourselves. We need to cast ourselves upon Almighty God, our Creator. A famous correspondent in the Times newspaper some years ago asked the question, "What's wrong with the world?" Probably the most penetrating of all the answers was from G.K. Chesterton. "Dear sir, I am, yours sincerely, G.K. Chesterton." That's precisely the answer. The heart of the human problem is the sinful human heart. In Romans 3, verse 23, we read, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." It is not popular to use the term sin today, but Jesus knew the problem, and he didn't mince his words. He spoke the truth when he said, "From the inside out of man's heart comes evil thoughts, acts of fornication, of theft, murder, adultery, greed and malice, fraud, indecency, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. These evil things all come from within, and they defile a man. Mark chapter 7, verses 21 to 23. Today we are concerned about outward appearances. God is concerned about our hearts. He sees the damage which sin has done in the world, causing division and bringing suffering and death. God gave us commandments to live by. Today they are ignored, and we are witnessing the consequences across our world. When we leave God, our Creator, out of our daily lives and decision-making, we have hell in our homes and streets. Only when we acknowledge our sin and repent of our sinful ways can our hearts be changed through His grace. Paul said to the Corinthian Christians, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things become new." 2 Corinthians 5, verse 17. Only Jesus Christ can forgive and break the power of sin in any life. The message of the inspired and infallible Word of God from Genesis to Revelation is grace. It is said that grace is the free, undeserved goodness and favour of God. The Bible teaches that Christ died to bring hopeless and helpless sinners to God. That is grace for the undeserving. The Bible message never changes and is still as relevant today as ever. There's no other solution in God's plan and purpose for sinful mankind. Thank God we are still living in the day of grace. There is hope for everyone throughout the world. Millions down through the ages have experienced God's life-transforming grace in Jesus Christ. He is still transforming lives by the power of Christ. Their Christ-like testimonies continue to speak across the world of the power of the gospel of grace. The essence of the doctrine of grace is that God is for all. God reaches out to everyone through Jesus, who himself was full of grace. Everyone needs his transforming and enabling grace. The day of grace will cease when Christ Jesus returns in glory to judge the world. Do you know God's grace in your life? In Ephesians 2 verses 8 to 10 we read, "For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them." Notice in this passage, Paul says, "For by grace you have been saved through faith." He is speaking to Christians who knew that saving grace. No one can save themselves by their good works or human effort. God saves people through the finished work of Christ on the cross. We are saved when we see ourselves as guilty, lost, helpless sinners in desperate need before a holy God in whom we will give account. Have you been saved? Are you trusting Christ today for salvation from sin and its consequences? You need to. Also, our text speaks of the words, "By grace we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus." This is amazing. In a sense, the word workmanship here means masterpiece. The moment a person puts their faith in Christ as Saviour, God begins a life-transforming work. The person becomes a new creation in Christ, and the Holy Spirit produces in them the fruit of Christ-likeness. This process takes a lifetime. As we obediently submit to God daily, he creates his masterpiece. God longs to fill earth and heaven with people who bear the image of his Son. Jesus taught and demonstrated what it was to love God and love our neighbour. Do you truly love God and your neighbour. The world changes when changed people love God and others. We need more visible expressions of God's grace in action today. Our daily prayer should be, let the beauty of Jesus be seen in me. Your life should glorify Christ by the way you live, through Christ-like words and actions. Finally, our text says, by grace we are created for good works, which God has prepared beforehand. No one is saved by good works, but we are saved by grace for good works. Christians are saved to serve others. When lives are totally committed to God's purpose and plan, he will bless others through them. We're called to love, care, and help others in Jesus' name and in every situation. Grace in action, just like Jesus throughout his life on earth. Conclusion. This is the day of God's grace. I am shocked by the depth of sin in the world, but I'm even more staggered by the amazing grace of God. There's nothing people need more today than God's grace. It is our only hope. God's grace is the power that can change this world. Will every Christian answer the call to be channels of his grace? Do you know God's saving and enabling grace in your life? Remember this, God can take a broken, rejected, hurting, and sinful life, wash it in the blood of Christ, put his spirit in it, and make it a blessing to humanity. That's his amazing grace. No one else can do that. Only God can change lives, homes, and communities. When I preach the gospel of grace, I know that God will change lives if people see their desperate need and respond to the Lord Jesus. I thank God for revealing his wonderful, saving, and enabling grace to me. By his grace, I am what I am, despite my weakness and failings. And by his grace, I will see my Saviour face to face in heaven one day. Do you have that hope? Without God's grace, you have no hope in this life and the next. Never reject God's grace in Jesus Christ. He calls you today to come and experience his saving grace in Jesus Christ. Why not respond and open your life fully to him? John Newton said, I am not what I might be. I am not what I ought to be. I am not what I wish to be. I am not what I hope to be. But I thank God I am not what I once was. And I can say with the great Apostle Paul, by the grace of God, I am what I am. That's the answer to this sinful, needy world. That's the answer to all of our lives. We need Christ, who is the one who is the channel of God's grace. May God bless you now and always. Amen. You gently break me.
saving us.